Hello friends, in the last video we discussed about the various clinical presentations of abortions, and one that was left was this missed abortion or early pregnancy loss. Now what is missed abortion, right? Now as the name suggests, missed meaning that it has been missed. What does that exactly mean? It exactly means that the pregnancy inside the uterus has died and it has not been expelled. So there is a pregnancy, but that is not growing. Now traditionally in the past, what had happened was, when ultrasound was not so widely available, the diagnosis was usually delayed, okay, because the woman would present with 3-4 months period of amenorrhea and the uterus is not growing at all, the signs and symptoms of pregnancy are subsiding, and then one would make the diagnosis of a missed abortion, right? But nowadays, with such widespread availability of ultrasound, ultrasound is available everywhere, right? So what happens is we diagnose this condition much, much earlier. And now this term missed abortion, which is common parlance, clinically has been replaced with the term early pregnancy loss, right? So this is what we are going to talk about. So friends, I have brought together a number of clinical scenarios in which missed abortion is a likely event or early pregnancy loss is a likely finding. Let us look at the first clinical situation. Okay, so a 25-year-old nulliparous woman, she comes with 1.5 month period of amenorrhea, right? She walks into the OPD with a complaint of cramping lower abdominal pain and an episode of spotting. So pain and spotting is there, right? So before moving on to the next step, remembering from the previous lecture, what is the differential diagnosis that is coming to our mind? One of the differential diagnoses that is coming to my mind is ectopic pregnancy, all right? And the other differential is that is coming to my mind is an abortion, all right? And of course, I will move ahead with my clinical examination, right? And before that, my next step, apart from the clinical examination, is going to be confirm the period of gestation. Always, always make it a point and make it a habit, right, of asking the LMP and then calculating the period of gestation in weeks. It becomes much easier to compare the period of gestation in weeks with the size of the uterus in weeks. So let's say in this case, the woman is 5 weeks. I'm just taking an example, right? So let's say that she is 5 weeks pregnant, right? On examination, the abdomen is soft, right? So that goes against the diagnosis of ectopic. In ectopic, there should be some perabdominal tenderness, right? On PV, the uterus is bulking and both the adnexa are free and non-tender, right? So there is no adnexal tenderness, there is no adnexal mass. Again, the diagnosis of ectopic becomes less likely, supporting my diagnosis of abortion. But this is just based upon the initial clinical examination, right? There is no active bleeding as well, right? So now, to make the confirmation between whether it is an ectopic or abortion, what do we do next? What would you do? You would order an ultrasound. So what does the ultrasound report show? Now the TVS report reveals that there is an intrauterine gestational sac of a mean sac diameter 10 mm. But what is important to note here is that there is no yolk sac and no embryo inside, right? So this is a transverse section of the uterus that we are seeing on an ultrasound. So we can see a round gestational sac, and this is in fact a true gestational sac and not just some fluid collection inside the uterus, which can sometimes be seen in an ectopic pregnancy. Now this is in fact a true gestational sac because you can appreciate these two concentric lines here, these hyperechoic, white hyperechoic concentric lines around the gestational sac. This is called as the double decidual sac sign, right? So when we see a double decidual sac sign, and of course with the underlying clinical scenario, we know that this is a true gestational sac. The point here is that there is no yolk sac, no embryo inside. So what do I tell the woman? Get rid of it. get rid of this pregnancy, it is not normal. No, that is not what I'm supposed to tell her or what you are supposed to tell her. What you have to understand is how do you manage, right? So of course, yes, you do confirm the period of gestation. Let's say we confirm the period of gestation to be 5 weeks based on her LMP. Now at 5 weeks, normally there definitely would be a gestational sac, and inside that sac there would be a yolk sac. What if it is not there, like in this scenario? That doesn't mean that the yolk sac will never come, right? So what we can do is we can ask her to wait another week. We can ask her to wait another week or 10 days and then repeat an ultrasound, and we can assure her or reassure her that sometimes, you know, it's a slow growing pregnancy, okay? And given more time, the yolk sac will come, okay? So with that in mind, how do we manage? By just reassuring and repeating the scan. We can repeat the scan in another 10 days, in another 7 to 10 days, and then we can again see whether the yolk sac has come or not. Okay, another important point that to be noted here is that this confirmation of period of gestation has been done by calculating from the last menstrual period. Now, there is a problem in this, right? Now, how many of us do actually remember the last menstrual period? We just remember a date and probably stick to it, right? So, the reliability of the last menstrual period is also very, very important. She simply could have miscalculated her LMP, and that would mean that we would lose a normal pregnancy otherwise. So, benefit of doubt is always given, okay? And one needs to repeat the scan in another 10 days and not jump to the conclusion that this is an early pregnancy loss. So when is it an early pregnancy loss? Let's say the period of gestation was 6 weeks in the same case scenario, and the transvaginal sonography showed an intrauterine gestational sac with a mean sac diameter of 27 mm. Now this is a big sac, all right? It's more than 25 mm. Okay, and yet there is no fetal pole or yolk sac to be seen inside. Now, when this gestational sac becomes more than 25 mm, we see nothing inside, an empty gestational sac, yes, that is when we make the diagnosis of missed abortion or early pregnancy loss. Okay, so what we can do is we can, like in the previous scenario, we can repeat the scan after 10 days, and if it still shows that nothing is growing inside, it is an early pregnancy loss. Or to begin with, if the gestational sac is more than 25 mm in diameter and there is no yolk sac or fetal pole inside, the diagnosis is early pregnancy loss. Now friends, moving on, let's talk about another clinical presentation. A 25-year-old nulliparous pregnant woman, so we already know that she is pregnant, with approximately 2 months period of amenorrhea, walks into the OPD with an ultrasound report she is concerned with. So she has already come with an ultrasound report. She has not come with a symptom, mind you. She has come with an ultrasound report. Day before, she had an episode of mild cramping. Now, I want to know, right? You want to know why, in fact, did she get an ultrasound done in the first place, right? So, she had an episode of mild cramping, lower abdominal pain, for which she got an ultrasound pelvis done. So, further on, I would want to know what other additional symptoms did she have. Did she have bleeding? No, she didn't have any bleeding. But yes, she did have some increased frequency of micturition and dysuria. So, there are urinary complaints which could, in fact, account for her lower abdominal pain as well. Okay, so now, of course, I want to see what the report is. So, let's move on. We saw the report. So now, what does the ultrasound report say, right? So the transvaginal report shows that there is, in fact, an intrauterine gestational sac. There is a fetal pole. There is a yolk sac. We can see here, there is the gestational sac. Inside that, there is a fetal pole, which has been measured to be about 5 mm in size. There is a yolk sac. All okay, but there is no cardiac activity, and this is what has made the woman worried. Okay, should it make you worried? Are you worried right now? That will depend upon after you confirm the period of gestation. So let's say that she is 5 weeks pregnant. Now by 5 weeks, usually the gestational sac does come into picture. By 5 weeks, a yolk sac is also seen in the transvaginal sonography. Fine. And cardiac activity usually takes longer. So, it can be seen as early as 5 weeks on a transvaginal sonography. But usually by 6 weeks, it is seen. So, I still have time. I can give her another week. All right. In the meanwhile, I need to assure her, right? So you need to reassure her that you are just 5 weeks pregnant. Do not worry. We can still wait for cardiac activity to appear. It takes about 6 weeks in most of the cases. Your embryo length is also only 5 mm. By 5 mm, usually cardiac activity comes, but even if it doesn't, some pregnancies are slow growing pregnancies. Maybe 6-7 mm, we wait till the cardiac activity actually comes, right? So this is the time kind of counseling that needs to be done. So we need to reassure. Another important thing is that, remember, in this clinical situation she had pain abdomen, so one could go for urine examination to rule out urinary tract infection, and she can be told that that is a possible cause for her pain abdomen that took place, because she did have complaint of increased frequency of micturition and dysuria. So in this particular case, yes, you can also rule out a urinary tract infection, right? So that is this clinical scenario. So as of yet, this is not an early pregnancy loss. If this is not, then what is? So now I've tweaked the clinical scenario or findings actually a little bit. It is the same woman who came with a period of amenorrhea, who came with some pain, and who was carrying an ultrasound report. All right. But what has changed here is the period of gestation is now 7 weeks. That's quite a lot. Okay. So the transvaginal sonography reveals the presence of an intrauterine gestational sac with an embryo inside, as you can see this embryo here, and the crown rump length was 10 mm, mind you, and yet there is no cardiac activity. Now this is what is early pregnancy loss, friends, when the crown rump length is more than 7 mm and yet there is no cardiac activity, right? Then what we make the diagnosis is early pregnancy loss or missed abortion. Now for those of you who do not know what crown rump length is, actually the embryo is measured in the sagittal section. The length of the embryo is measured in the sagittal section, all right, from the crown to the edge of the buttock. So that is the crown rump length, all right? And if it's more than 7 mm, no cardiac activity, our diagnosis is a early pregnancy loss. So friends, whenever the diagnosis of early pregnancy loss is made, the next step is, of course, that pregnancy is already lost, it needs to be terminated, right? So that is what is going to be our next step. So that is why the decision or to diagnose early pregnancy loss is something that is really guarded, because we do not want to unnecessarily end up terminating a pregnancy which could have possibly grown. Okay, so summarizing all the events, what is the diagnosis of early pregnancy loss? How do we come to the diagnosis? So there are certain clinical scenarios. There could be an empty gestational sac to begin with, right? So there is an empty gestational sac which is more than 25 mm in the mean sac diameter, then the diagnosis of early pregnancy loss is made. Normally, first the gestational sac comes, then inside the gestational sac there is a yolk sac that comes. After that, and fetal pole will come, and after that, in the fetal pole, the cardiac activity is going to come. Okay, so whenever there is an empty gestational sac which is less than 25 mm in diameter, we can wait. Let's say that this stage never came. Let's say that it has been 2 weeks It has been 2 weeks and yet there is no yolk sac inside the gestational sac. Then again, the diagnosis of early pregnancy loss is made. Let's say there was a yolk sac inside a gestational sac. This is showing a yolk sac inside the gestational sac. Okay, and we decided that we'll wait for the fetal pole to come. Now let's say it's been 11 days and yet the fetal pole has not come. Okay, this doesn't happen. Then again, the diagnosis of early pregnancy loss is made. Okay, now the other thing is there is a fetal pole. There is no cardiac activity in that fetal pole. How long can we wait for the cardiac activity to come? Like I told you, if the fetal pole is more than 7 mm in diameter and there is no cardiac activity that has come, then again the diagnosis of early pregnancy loss is made. If the fetal pole is less than 7 mm crown rump length, okay, then we can still wait for the cardiac activity to come. So this is in summary how the early pregnancy loss is diagnosed.